Meanwhile, good news for Filipino professionals from more than 20 fields planning to move to British Columbia in Canada. The province has made it easier for them to work in their respective fields by making international professional credential recognition fairer, more transparent, and efficient. The new International Credentials Recognition Act, which took effect last July 1st, saw barriers like the requirement of Canadian work experience removed. Cliff Belica of the Philippine Nurses Association in BC was among the Filipino representatives invited by the BC government to discuss the Fair Credential Recognition Law. He says the new law will also assign a superintendent to oversee 18 regulatory bodies to ensure the faster recognition of international credentials.
It's a step forward. Hopefully, it's a start. There will be more professions that will go under this. That's what our understanding is.
And finally, we go to the province of Alberta in Canada, where the Calgary Stampede is on its 112th year, setting an attendance record of 350,000 during its downtown parade. For 9 years now, one of the most awaited events at the Stampede is the Pinoy Almusal Stampede Breakfast, which also served a record 6,000 people this year.
I just want to take a minute to pay tribute to the Filipino community in Alberta and in Canada. Yeah, and I want to say you are such an important part of our amazing, diverse country. There are nearly 250,000 Filipino Albertans, and you guys are contributing so much to this amazing province.
Attendees were served traditional Filipino breakfast like longganisa, fried eggs, and fried rice.
We are so honored na marami pong dumating na mga representation galing sa federal government at saka yung ating mga provincial governments po ay nandito nagre-represent po. Ibig sabihin po, malaking pagkakataon para sa mga kababayan nating Pilipino na makilala din sila ng gobyerno.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the rundown.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky confident his country is close to achieving its goal of NATO membership. This despite the military alliance not offering a political invitation to join the NATO summit in Washington. Zelensky stresses Ukraine joining NATO would be mutually beneficial for both parties.
Speaking about the war, you can't even sometimes use the word success, because success is no war in your country, in your life. Success when you don't lose your family, that is success. And to survive and to win this war, it will be, that will be a real success for us. I think we have to stop speak that for Ukraine, the membership in NATO, this is success. I think this is success for both of us. We strengthen NATO. We're strong guys. We have strong army. And we are fighting against this tyrant, Putin.
NATO members issued a declaration in support of Ukraine, promising additional aid and pledging to back its membership bid. NATO Chief Jens Stoltenberg reiterated this promise alongside Zelensky.
President Zelensky, in our meeting just now, you and I agreed that all of these elements, a NATO command, more funding, more military support, more security agreements, and more interoperability, constitute a bridge to NATO membership and a very strong package for Ukraine. Ukraine's future is in NATO. I welcome your progress on reforms, and as you continue this important work, we will support you on your irreversible path to NATO membership.
The U.S. announces a new security package for Ukraine worth $225 million. Washington, Ukraine's biggest supporter, has provided more than $50 billion in military aid since 2022, when the Russian invasion began, but assistance was delayed in Congress for several months, leading to a shortage of weapons, which Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says gave Russia the upper hand. Ahead of their bilateral meeting in Washington, U.S. President Joe Biden again assured his Ukrainian counterpart of Washington's unwavering support. The Israeli military publishes findings of the first probe on its own security failings during the October 7 Hamas attack. The probe examined the chain of events and conduct of security forces. It acknowledged it failed to protect citizens in kibbutz and in Kibbutz Be'eri, one of the worst hit communities. The investigation found the military was unprepared for the scenario of a massive infiltration of militants into Israel, had inadequate forces in the area, and failed to properly alert residents. The military presented the report to Be'eri's residents, many of whom are among the tens of thousands of Israelis still displaced since October 7.